soma despise. For the recipe, this is a love attack. I know when our body's back, it's just like any fat. It retracts before impact. And just like fashion, it's a passion for the wizard and hip. Hi folks, Dr. Hendrickson here again. I hope you have been enjoying the course so far, albeit it has been plagued with technical difficulties, I know, and some other downfalls, and I do apologize for these inconveniences. Hope things are working a little bit better for everyone. I am in the process of doing some updating to our e-learning site. Because of all of these delays and technical difficulties, I've decided to change the schedule to reflect more about what's going on with the online text. The online text is not divided into weeks like our schedule is. It's divided into sections, and so I think it's better for us if I change our schedule and make it section rather than weekly. That way you can have a little bit more time to complete the assignments, and you don't have to feel so pressured to get them done within a certain amount of time. I have increased the due dates and the completion dates for the section 3, which involves rhythm and meter. You now have until the end of this week to finish that. So if anyone needs to go back, I noticed that several of you have already completed it and you've done fine. So if you don't have to do it, then don't worry about it. But if necessary, you'll have that opportunity to go back and revisit. So what we're going to focus on, though, in this video will be more than simply Section 3. We're going to be talking about Section 5 and Section 6. Section 5 in particular, dealing with major scales and key signatures. And then, of course, in Section 6, we'll be talking about building major scales. So I encourage you to watch and just to see what's going on with both of those. I'm going to skim a little bit on the rhythm and meter just to give a little bit of a background for those that might need it, but I'm not going to spend a great deal of time on Section 3. We're going to learn more actually do more with Section 4, 5, and 6. So do watch and take a listen, and of course you can always fast forward through the stuff that you already know. If it's stuff that you are familiar with, don't worry about it, just keep on going. As always, if you have questions about anything, please do send me an email, or you can work out a time with me to meet face to face if that is helpful to you. Also, please note that there is a change in the midterm. I have made the midterm happening later. It's actually going to start on November 5th, and you'll have until the 11th to complete the midterm. So that gives us a little bit more time, a little bit more leeway. I know many of you have been experiencing some technical difficulties with both e-learning and with the Connect for Education site. So this is to sort of even up the playing field a little bit for us. So do take advantage of it. If you have questions, again, please get in touch with me. Okay, so let's take a look at what happens next. All right, so once you have gotten into e-learning and you've either clicked on the login link or perhaps you've gone directly to the Connect for Education site, which you see up here in the address bar, obviously we just put in our username and our password. And hit enter, and there we go, and click on our class, of course, and then our home page comes up with all of the sections. So we're going to go briefly look at Section 3. Don't get the classes and the sections confused. We're going to go to the section rhythm and meter. Again, if you've already done this, fast forward or just go get yourself a cup of coffee, whatever. You can look through the section overview, the outline and objectives. Everyone should be able to do that. If you need to, here it is. It's just showing you. I encourage you to watch the little video. It does talk about what you're going to be learning. Also, you can go to the outline and objectives. All that does is bring up a list of the topics that are going to be discussed. If you click on these, that shows you over here what the objective is for each of the topics. And as you have probably seen by now, all of the topics have this. So all of the sections, excuse me, have that section overview and the outline and the objectives. Okay, so let's just again take a look at it. You have some classes here, 6, 7, and 8, that deal with rhythm and specifics. And so you have an introduction, a pulse and tempo, and rhythms with rests and dots and ties. Hopefully everyone has experienced this and has done well. If you are having difficulties, please get in touch with me if you need further explanation. But I'm going to click on this first class here, and I want everyone to remember you have these icons up here at the top of this page. Listen to the lecture. This will actually read all of the text that's there. The show me icon, which again I've demonstrated before, that shows you everything. This highlights all of the key words. I'm not using the Collaborate or the Download Center, but the Discover video is handy. So I encourage you to take a look at that. It does give some demonstrations about some of the things that we're talking about with respect to rhythm and meter. So it is quite helpful. So do take advantage of these little tools. And remember too, you've always got the keyboard down here. You just click on it. Keyboard all you wish. The player is probably something that you're not going to use much, but it will be queued up anytime there's an example. Like for example, here is the string quintet by Franz Schubert. If you click on that, the player pops up with that excerpt. Okay, so hopefully you can take advantage of these things and use them at your disposal. Now, when we go back to the course outline and we see the different classes, let's go on to the next section, which is section 4, major scales and key signatures. And again, it's the same deal, folks. You click on this section overview and you can watch this little video here. So let's just watch this together.
Musicians use scales to organize the pitches in a piece of music. In this section of the course, the focus is on major scales. You will learn how to write and transpose major scales and learn about the different functions of each scale degree. You will also learn how to identify and write major key signatures and how to use the circle of fifths.
Okay, so that gives us a little bit of an overview of what we're going to be talking about in this particular section. And you can watch this as many times as you wish. One of the things that you saw on this video was the words scale degrees. And so there are scale degrees, tonic, supertonic, median. These are things that are going to be coming up in future topics too, so do understand what those are. Those scale degrees are important that you know what they are, because they will appear on quizzes. Okay, so let's go ahead to the next page, which is the chapter outline and the learning objectives. Again, it's the same thing that you see in all the other chapters. You click on the topic, it shows you what the objectives are for that specific topic. Excuse me, and then we go on to the actual lessons. This is a definition of a scale, and these paragraphs are well written. A scale, from the Italian word scala, meaning ladder, is a collection of pitches arranged in an ascending order. Like the steps on a ladder, you can ascend by step through the pitches in a scale. Here, a scale that moves step by step from middle C to middle C, an octave higher. This particular scale is called the C major scale. Much of this, I'm sure, for many of you is old hat, but if you play it, clicking on the little speaker icon, open up your keyboard, find middle C, which is what this note is, and play it on your keyboard. Okay, so you can have fun with that and experience it firsthand from the standpoint of the keyboard. Here is some musical examples showing you scalar passages in music. I encourage you to look at these and listen to them. All music melody is made from scales. They're an integral part of music. Again, I point to these icons here at the top of the page. You know, if you want to have somebody read to you, as I just did, probably with a much nicer speaking voice, you can listen to the lecture, and then of course the show me icons and so forth. So please do take advantage of these. We go to the next page and we have the diatonic and chromatic scales. Those are two types. Diatonic, dia literally meaning two, and chromatic meaning a half step or half of that, or actually chromatic really literally means two colors. The two colors of the keyboard, for example, black and white. And this is, of course, showing you about half steps. If you look at this, and if we look at the chromatic part of it, and the reason they're saying that is diatonic meaning that you're actually moving up a different letter name. You have two letter names there, A to B, right? It's the same pitches. I think we might remember when we talked about accidentals, that term enharmonic, meaning that every pitch has its has the propensity to be more than itself. A flat, excuse me, B flat in this case is the same note as A sharp. So we have the ability to do this again and again just by clicking on the reset button, but I want you to understand the difference between diatonic, two letters, and chromatic, one letter, but it's still moving in the same direction. Generally speaking, diatonic half steps involve different letter names, right, and staff positions. Chromatic half steps involve the same letter name. So there you go. Whole step, the equivalent of two half steps. If we click on Show Me, we can see that from here to here is a whole step. And if I ask it to show us again, it is actually showing us on the keyboard where those are. And if we were to pull up our keyboard, we could, let's just scroll down a little bit so we can see that, we could go to the A and play it ourselves. There's the whole step. And on a piano keyboard, it's great to be able to relate whole steps and half steps because you have them spelled out for you. A whole step on a piano keyboard is a white key to a white key, provided there's a black key in between. Okay, so hopefully that is clear to everyone. All right, and then this is showing you a chromatic scale. This would be what's called a chromatic scale because you can see what's going on here with the pitches. Although they have really done something a little unusual in that they're showing you some diatonic motion in here. So you'll find discrepancies in music, ladies and gentlemen. Remember that it is not an exact science, so reasonably so, but there are some discrepancies. And then we have chromatic and diatonic semitones. Please don't get too bogged down into those. They're going to be on your quizzes, though, so I encourage you to take a look at them. All right, and then if we continue on, we see about the major scale. One of the things that you're going to want to remember about a major scale is that it contains a pattern. And every major scale has this pattern. It says here there are 5 whole steps and 2 half steps in a major scale. And this is true for every major scale, not just the C major scale, but every major scale. It doesn't matter what note you start on, as long as it has this order of whole, whole, half, whole, whole, half, it's going to be a major scale. Now, for some people, an easier way to remember that is understanding that as long as there's a half step between the third and the fourth degree, and the seventh and the eighth degree, the rest of them are all whole steps. So that's going to be a major scale. It's only when you run into half steps that occur between any of the other degrees that you're going to be either outside of a major scale or you're going to have some other type of scale that's of a different modality. So here we go. Showing you 2 whole steps, 1 half, whole, 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 and a half. And that organization is present in every single major scale. And here it's talking about the key of C major. Part of the terminology that we sometimes use as musicians, and particularly in music theory, is we call these tonal centers. And this particular scale has the tonal center of C. A song or a melody that would have these notes present, or a series of these notes present, and maybe start on C and perhaps end on C, or that C in particular, had a tonal center of C, or that it was in the key of C major. This is talking about that just a little bit, and then it says, a composition that is based on the scale of C major is said to be in the key of C major. In other words, most, if not all, of the notes in the piece that is in the key of C major will come from the C major scale. Now, this example they give is Joy to the World. I'll let you play through that, but you get the idea, I hope. Okay, so if we continue on and we talk about transposing a major scale, this is talking about moving the scale by the order of whole steps and half steps, which you could do. You could just simply transpose it. I'm going to let you read through this, and if you have questions about it, certainly get in touch with me. But note here it says, we could move our C major scale up a half step so that it begins on C sharp. In order to maintain the correct pattern of whole steps and half steps in this scale, we would need to raise all of the scale degrees by the same amount. I hope everyone is understanding that. So you'd have to put sharp symbols by every single one of these, okay? So here, let's just have it show us. And this is wicked to play, but I'll pull up the keyboard so you can see a little bit of it. You would start on C sharp, go to D sharp, go to E sharp, which enharmonically is the same as F, then you'd have to have that half step, F sharp, G sharp, A sharp, and then B sharp, and then that half step from 7 to 8. So I hope that clears it up for you a little bit. We could do the same thing with flats. We could take everything down a half step. That's what this is showing us. And then we could change it completely to a different note if we wanted to, but we would have to move the notes accordingly. Here we're seeing the notes scaled in starting on G rather than on C. And I'll just show you here, if I tell it to show me, it's going to have to add something special to make this work. See there, it's adding a sharp. That's so that we can have that half step between the 7th and the 8th degree. If I ask it to show me again, note that that disappears. So the point made here is this scale starting on G, if I were to start on G and play to the next G, it's almost a major scale, just for those last two notes, right? And that's why we add that sharp symbol to give us that leading tone. So I hopefully that is clear to everyone. Okay. And of course you can do this with starting on any note as long as you have this necessary series of whole steps and half steps. Here it is again on the D major scale, and in order to have the necessary whole steps, we had to add two sharps. And this is going to lead us into our discussion on key signatures. So I encourage you to continue watching as we begin to talk about key signatures and other aspects of major scales, because they are integral. One of the reasons why we want to talk about this is because if you had to put, about key signatures, that is, if you had to put an accidental by every single note that required it, you can already tell that's going to be really cumbersome. And essentially what happens is, in a key signature, it places all of the accidentals that you need at the beginning of the piece of music, so you can see right away what is sharp or what is flat, depending upon the tonal center or the key signature. Here we have a discussion on the scale degree syllables and the scale degree names. You can see them here: tonic, supertonic, mediant, sub dominant, and so forth. If you click on these, it's giving you some examples. So I'm going to let you play with those. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. You may have heard someone singing that. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. And that is just simply, they're called solfege syllables. This is a system that was devised in Europe and is still used today quite extensively throughout Europe in music education. It is also used here in the United States, although not quite as extensively as in Europe, but it is used. You may have learned this in school if you took part in your high school chorus, or you might even have learned it in band or in your general music courses. Okay, so we'll be talking about these more as we go along, but do read up on these, because this does tell you a great deal about what they are. All right. When we continue on, we see we have other things like the practice worksheet on whole steps and half steps. You've come across these before. And then you also have quizzes, which would be the next thing that you would click on. So I encourage you to look into all of this. Okay, so after this, let's go on next to our key signatures, I believe. Okay, so now we begin to work on a discussion about key signatures in major scales. And this is introducing you to something that we call a pattern, a tetrachord, if you want to use the fancy term. But it's just grouping some of these notes into a pattern, the whole half, and the whole note there in the middle by itself, and then another whole half. Really and truly, when we talk about scales and key signatures, most musicians don't really think about tetrachords. Most musicians just play what's put in front of them if they read music and or sing. When we don't really think about it with respect to, is there a tetrachord present there? I mean, most musicians don't even look at that. But this is just sort of giving you another way to look at scales. And, you know, you can do this show me business here. I'll show you. Tetrachord, tetra meaning four. And it's just simply showing you there are four tetrachords present in each major scale, two tetrachords present. There's four notes in a tetrachord, but there's two tetrachords present in each major scale. This is how they are made up. That's pretty much all that there is. But this is a key thing to remember, and that's why they include it in this box. When a new major scale is built by adding a tetrachord to the second half of an existing major scale, the seventh scale degree of the new scale must be raised by a half step. This is to create that idea of a leading tone. And here's some examples. Here is the G major scale with an F sharp, with the seventh degree raised. Now here it is without raising that seventh degree. Okay, so you get the idea, you gotta raise the seventh. And in order to do that, you gotta use an accidental. Now, I'm going to take this out of context for a second because this is showing you two examples of Joy to the World, one of them starting on C and the other starting on E. Now, this is gonna sound a little bit bizarre. Here's the first one. So that's getting kind of close to Christmas, isn't it? So I guess that's okay. Now, I'm going to pop my headphones on because I'd like to hear this next one myself a little bit clearer. So let's see what we got. So hopefully right away you can tell that doesn't sound like Joy to the World to me. I mean, it has the same rhythm, but it's obviously a different tonality. So yeah, that's because it's not using any accidentals to create that necessary sequence of whole steps and half steps that's present in a major scale. Well, if we were to continue on, we could see that we would use accidentals to make this happen. And if I play a little bit of this for you, you'll notice. So hopefully right away you noticed, oh yeah, that sounds more like Joy to the World. Okay, well, so what we've done, essentially what key signatures do, is we take all of these accidentals, I mean, look at them. They're everywhere, and that's really kind of makes it hard to read. So all we're doing is we're taking all of those and we're placing them at the beginning of the piece of music. And so we know, for example, that F is going to be sharp, C is going to be sharp, G is going to be sharp, and D is going to be sharp throughout the entire piece, unless otherwise marked. And it's not going to be otherwise marked in Joy to the World, I can assure you. So if I hit play on this one, it's going to sound exactly the same as it did before. So there you go. And you can play with these all you want for hours and hours and hours if you want to hear Christmas carols. Enjoy it. Okay, so let's move on. Building major scales that use flats. Again, I'm going to let you look through all of this, but there are flat tonalities or flat modalities or flat tonal centers, and there are sharp tonal centers. Just take some time to explore and read through this. Use the show me buttons because this is going to demonstrate for you how these things work. You're going to be learning about something called the circle of fifths. And here we go. Here it is. This is an amazing tool. You can see that it looks very much like a clock. Why do they call it the circle of fifths? Well, if you go clockwise around it, take a look at this. C, G, D, A, and E. Well, C to the next one, G. C, D, E, F, G, 5. G to D, G, A, B, C, D, 5. Okay, you get the picture? That's how this works. Now, looking at it from the flat side, by the way, I should mention to you that the right side is the sharp side, the left side is the flat side. If you continue on, if we started with C flat and go to G flat, that's 5, G flat to D flat, that's 5, D flat to A flat, that is 5, and so forth. But there's something missing from this circle of fifths that is sometimes present in other examples, in that there's no numbers present. This tells you what the keys are, but it doesn't really tell you how many accidentals are in each. If we start with C, that'd be 0, because the key of C contains no accidentals. It doesn't need them to do the major scale. The key of G has 1, the key of D has 2, the key of A, 3, the key of E, 4, the key of B, 5, and the key of F sharp, 6, and the key of C sharp, 7 sharps. So if we walked around this way, that's what we would get. Now if we walk around this way, it would become the circle of fourths. C to F is 4, C, D, E, F, F to B flat is 4, F, G, A, B flat. Got it? So we could have this is 1 flat, this is 2 flats, 3 flats, 4 flats, and so forth. So you can think of it that way. It might make it a little bit easier for you. It's entirely up to you. I will let you play with this, but it's kind of cool how this works. Note that they give you major keys. So they're showing you what the key signature looks like, and they're showing you the scale, and they're showing you the flat equivalent. Now, you could also look at minor keys this way. Let's look at E minor. Notice how there's one sharp. That's going to become significant later on. Okay, so hopefully this is making some sense to you. I know I'm going relatively fast, but you can take all the time you want to look at this and tear it apart. You've got a key signature exercise where it's going to ask you to build some major scales using key signatures, and then you also have, of course, other exercises that ask you to build ascending major scales. This is the practice mode. And then descending major scales, what they're asking you for is to put in the correct number of accidentals. Okay, and then the next thing would be our key signatures. Okay, last but not least, we begin the study of key signatures themselves, major scales and key signatures. And here this is talking about using key signatures like we had talked before. If we had to put accidentals by every single note that needed them, why, that would be extraordinarily cumbersome, and we wouldn't want to have to fool with that. So instead, we put all those accidentals at the beginning in the form of a key signature. Take a look here. It's showing you the C sharp major scale. It's going to take all of those sharps and put them in the key signature. I'd like you to pay close attention to where they're being placed. There is a pattern. It's very hard to see, but it is there. This is showing you the order of the sharps, and that means it's the order in which they are placed in the key signature. It's always the same. F, C, G, D, A, E, B for flats. It's the reverse order. It's F, C, G, D, A, E, B for sharps. For flats, it's the reverse order. B, E, A, D, G, C, F. There's neat little acronyms you can put to this. Fat cats go down alleys eating bugs for the sharps, and battle ends and down goes Charlie's friend for the flats, if you want to do that. I recommend using a combination of both the circle of fifths and the order of sharps and flats to help you build key signatures. And I'm going to place a link on our e-learning site that will bring up that circle of fifths, so you can have that at your disposal if you want to print it off, and that will also help you do construct key signatures and identify key signatures. So I ask you to continue looking through this. This is showing you order of sharps. Pretty cool stuff. Showing you all the key signatures and what they look like. And then it's going to go through the same procedure with the flat keys. We'll just look at the order of flats. Now, if we go back, I'm going to go back a page just to take a look at the order of sharps for just a second. You noticed up, down, up, down, and then it goes down again, and it sort of repeats. Up, down, up, down, down, up, down. This order is specific for sharps and must be observed. The reasoning being we want to stay within the five lines and four spaces as much as possible. Now, we sort of break that rule with G sharp, but it does go back in with the bass clef. A is also an exception. It breaks the pattern. Up, down, up, down, down, up, down. But that's just the way it goes. And again, music is not an exact science. But that's the order. That needs to be the same every time. Now, when we look at the order of flats, it's a little bit more organized. Down, up, down, up. So, and it's always in that order, B, E, A, D, G, C, F. Here it's showing you all of the flat keys. Notice that it always starts with C, and C is always zero. So there you go. I hope that this is something that is not too terribly confusing for you. Showing you different versions of Joy to the World. We got through that. This is showing you about transposition, making transpositions with key signatures is relatively easy when you know how. And we can also look at the circle of fifths now in a different light. Notice how they put the numbers back in. Okay, so I'm going to let you guys play with this, take a look at it, read through it. If you have questions, shoot me an email. Please note, there will be another discussion topic for you, and I'm really entertained by all of your answers, and I will be posting some responses very soon. So thank you. Hope you're enjoying it. Please let me know if you have questions, and have a great week.